Okay, so before this, you have learned about the membrane transport, am I right? About the what do you call active transport and then passive transport. We know that in active transport, they need a ion channel for the ion to move in and out. But for passive transport, it just following the permeability of the membrane. So the water can flow in and can flow out. It's not necessarily the water, it could be the solute. So the solute can move in and out freely, depending on the solubility of the membrane itself. Okay, so what are the things that we know when the solute can move in and out? We learned and we say it is the osmosis process. So by learning osmosis process, instead of just knowing that the process itself, we also have the kind of solutions. So we have three kind of solutions, all right, by which we have the hypertonic solution. We also have the isotonic solution, and also we have the hypotonic solution. So this is typo error, sorry, yeah. Okay, for hypertonic solution, usually it is must be more than 0.85% of sodium chloride. So by that, our body fluid, our osmolarity of body fluid itself, it is, what is the osmolarity of our body fluid? Anybody know? What is the value or osmolarity of our body fluid? Ada tak? Anybody can answer me? It is? Can you recall back? Our body fluid is not one, is not two. So our body fluid osmolarity is 290 milli osmol. So actually our body fluid osmolarity is 290 milli osmol. So sometimes our body fluid can be more than that and can be lesser than that. So what our body can help, that's why our system has the homeostasis process. So this homeostasis, we try to balance out our body fluid osmolarity back to 290 milliosmol per liter. So if let's say you drink a lot of water, what will happen to your body? To maintain the osmolarity, your kidney will try to help out by releasing the water via urination, okay? Or else by the what, sweating process and so forth. If let's say you dehydrated, you lack of water, you drink a lack of water, or you are in the desert, for example, pergi gurun Sahara ke, and then our body try to conserve the water. So which part of the body try to conserve the water is the role of the kidney by the helps of the other system. So we call it as the what, homeostasis process. But in this case, when we talk about the osmolarity, the isotonic in our body fluid, it is 0.85%. Sometimes you might find in a book, they write it 0.8, 0.9% of sodium chloride. So nothing, got not much different lah. Okay, so it can be plus minus. Okay, look at this. When, let's say when we have a red blood cells. So our red blood cells are actually are in a certain shape. So it's not like a sphere shape, but it is in a biconcave, biconcave or biconvex shape. All right. So why our red blood cell has been made to be this shape? Okay. Remember, when you learn physiology, you need to understand the structure of the organ itself, the structure of the tissue itself, the structure of the cell itself before you relate to the physiology or the functions of the cell. So let's take a look at the red blood cell. When you take a look at the red blood cell, you might see that the red blood cell shape like what? They have a paler in the middle. So paler means apa tu paler? A pale color in the middle, and they have a rim at the outer layer. Why it has been made like this? So that it can get the water in, okay? And it can take away the water out, and it can still maintain in its shape. Can you imagine if our red blood cells is the shape of a ball? Maksudnya dia macam like a bowling ball or a ball, a balloon, a fully flated balloon, inflated balloon. So if let's say it is already a circle like this, when the water coming in, so it cannot be resistance. That's why God have made our red blood cells is like this, and you see, like if you see laterally, okay, so that when it gets water, it can still inflate. When the water coming out, it can still maintain its shape. Okay, thanks to God. All right. However, when you put our red blood cells in a solute by which it is hypertonic, So the contents of solute inside our red blood cell will be flowing out by the process of osmosis. So remember, whenever the sodium is, the water will follow. By looking at this condition, hypertonic solution, so the sodium is actually a lot at the outer layer or the outer environment. So when the sodium is outer environment, so the water inside the red blood cell will follow out. Wherever the concept is, wherever the salt is, wherever the sodium is, the water will follow. Please keep in mind this term until you learn in urinary systems, okay? You will still bring this idea until the urinary system later, okay? So when the water flow out, the cell will be shrink, all right? In the isotonic solutions, so the water is freely move in and out of the red blood cell. So nothing going to happen to the red blood cells. But when you put a red blood cell in the hypotonic solution, okay, or the typo error is bothering me. Okay, when you put the red blood cells inside the what do we call the hypotonic solutions, so the water will follow the sodium inside the red blood cells and will cause the lysing of the red blood cells, and later the red blood cell will be burst out. Okay, now let's take a look at the osmotic fragility test, big fragility test. Okay, back to our practical sessions today. What is the clinical significance behind the test? Okay, so RBC, okay, are actually less resistant to lysing than normal RBC, meaning that it can break easily. If our red blood cells is sphere in shape, okay, macam I cakap tadi, is sphere in shape, so the water, whenever the water coming in, it will be less resistant. Maksudnya dia tak tahan lasak. So when it is less resistant, it easily can burst out. So the conditions, okay, the clinical significance are, for example, like in the hereditary spherocytosis. Sphero is sphere in shape, cytosis is the cell, right? So the red blood cell itself are in a sphere cell. So when it is in a sphere cell, instead of like normal red blood cells, if I can keep fine, if I come back. Okay, so the cell, when they get into the hypotonic solution, it will be burst out. All right, another situation is for hemolytic anemia. So spherocytosis and hemolytic anemia, they are less resistant and break easily compared to the normal RBC. All right, so let's take a look at the cells. For example, what are the cells that are more resistant, meaning that their shape is actually a shrink already. So for example, like if you see in the sickle cell anemia, the red blood cells are like in a crescent moon. Okay, so when it like a crescent moon, it can contain a lot more water inside it. Therefore, this RBC are more resistant to lysing compared to the normal RBC. So another example is in thalassemia. Whatever I said more resistance or less resistance, it's actually comparing to the normal RBC. Okay, here is the osmotic fragility test. We will given you 10 tubes, all right? Inside this 10 tube number 1 is 0.85% of sodium chloride, followed by 0.75, 0.65, 0.55, 45, 40, 35, 20, 10, and 0%. So 0% means there is no sodium chloride at all. So meaning it is a distilled water. All right. So let's take a look at this. What will happen is that you will take a sample of blood of any patient. For example, like you yourself, either you don't know whether you have a thalassemia or not, whether you have a spherocytosis or not, whether you have a sickle cell anemia or not. Okay, we will take out your blood samples. For example, if you want to do, we're going to take out your blood samples, and then we have the tube number 1 until tube number 5, tube number 10 with a different sodium chloride concentration. Okay, and then we take 5 milliliters of variables sodium chloride just now, we put inside one tube, and we take 0.02 milliliters or 20 microliters of a patient red blood cells or your red blood cells, and then we put in a tube, And then later we will shake the tube. We cover it with the paraffin. Okay, before we do anything, we cover it with paraffin and then we just shake it gently. All right? And then when you done put tube number 1 until tube number 10, all right, with the different concentrations and 20 microliter of your blood, and then you cover with paraffin and then you let it settle for 20 minutes after you mix it, let it settle for 20 minutes, and then you going to centrifuge the blood itself. While you like gently mix your red blood cell, you can actually see already either the red blood cells is lysed or creamy, or either red blood cell is hemolysis, undergo hemolysis or not. If you take a look at the red blood cells with the solute just now, okay, when you shake, you will see that if it is clear red, it is appear red and it is clear, meaning that the cells undergo hemolysis. If the cells look like cloudy, so meaning that the cells does not undergo hemolysis. All right, okay, that's the difference. Later we'll take a look at it. Okay, and then you centrifuge in 2000 revolutions per minute, and for 5 minutes, and then the supernatant will be transferred into the cuvette. Okay, so why you need to transfer into the cuvette? Because you need to see the concentrations of the hemoglobin inside the RBC itself. Okay, what happened when the red blood cells burst out? Anybody can answer? You put a red blood cells inside the hypotonic solutions. So your red blood cells will, the water will be inside your red blood cells, and then your blood cell will be burst. So when your red blood cell is bursting, the one that will come out from the red blood cell is the hemoglobin, the iron ring, the hemoglobin and so forth. So this photospectral photometer, it will detect the concentrations of the hemoglobin. So the higher percentage of the hemoglobin inside the supernatant, meaning that the cells undergo a lot more hemolysis. The lesser amount of the hemoglobin content in your supernatant, meaning that the cell does not undergo hemolysis. That what does it mean by the concentrations of the supernatant. Okay, once you transfer everything, tube number 1, tube number 2 until tube number 10, all right, the supernatant, and then you can see actually if the cells does not undergo hemolysis, okay, you will see that there is a pellet down below there, meaning that there is a red blood cell down there. Okay, if the cell undergo hemolysis, you can see only a tiny bit of the red blood cell membrane. Okay, and then under 540 nanometer, you will observe. Okay, so how can you calculate the percentage of the hemolysis of each of the supernatant? You might see that the absorbance of the test supernatants, mean whatever result you get, for example, you already write down, for the red blood cells in 0.85% of sodium chloride, you will get that. You will measure using the spectrophotometer and then you will get the readings. So the readings under this absorbent, the reading for each tube, you need to divide by the absorbance of 100% hemolysis. So 100% hemolysis kat mana? This one got hemolysis or not? This one got hemolysis or not? Alright, so which part is 100% hemolysis? And then you will get that any tube over here divided by the 100% of hemolysis. Alright, the absorbent, yeah, please remember, this is the absorbent of the test tube and this is the absorbent of the 100% of hemolysis, and then you multiply with 100. And then once you get the results, okay, when you get the percentage of the hemolysis of each of the tube in this by different concentrations over here, you need to take this number and then plot in a graph with the percentage of sodium chloride and also the percentage of hemolysis. Okay, now let's take a look at the results and the evaluation. Okay, so for example, I take a tube number 5 for the patient A, and this is a normal for patient B. For patient A, for normal, usually the percentage of hemolysis is 45%, but for patient A, the percentage of hemolysis is 28.4%. So what does that mean? Either this is more resistance or less resistance. So in normal solution, in the normal red blood cells, the percentage of hemolysis is 45. But for this patient, the percentage of hemolysis is lesser than normal. So when it is lesser to hemolyze compared to the normal one, meaning that the patient is, the RBC of that patient is much more resistance. So please bear in mind, when I say the patients who have the RBC is much more resistance to hemolyze, meaning that this patient would might have the thalassemia or sickle cell anemia. If let's say the patient B, this is not 12 lah, it should be like 78, for example, yeah. This is just a number, change to 78. If let's say the patient B, for the normal individual, it would take 45% to hemolyze, but for the patient B, it would take 72% to hemolyze, meaning that the patient B, the red blood cells for patient B, is much more easier to hemolyze, mean it is less resistance to the hypotonic solution. So when it is less resistance, it means that the RBC for patient B would be the inner spherocytosis, or it would be what? And then hemolytic anemia. Okay? Did you get my point? Easy, right? Just logic thinking, you can get the concept already. Okay, and then once you get the readings, you can make a graph like this. You can plot a graph like this. Alright, I want you to plot the graph later on. Okay, before that, okay, I want you to open your, stop sharing for a while. I want to open your chat box. Okay, look at the chat box down there. Okay, I paste one link for the Google document. I want you to fill, I give you 5 minutes to fill out this Google document right now. This would be your attendance for this practical session before I continue with my session. Okay, so I give you 5 minutes to digest and to fill in the form. Okay, go get the form in the chat box.
Doctor, matrix number is our student ID, right?
Yes, correct.
Thank you.
All right. I give you 5 minutes, yeah? We will continue at 3:43. Okay, please bear in mind, during my class, I would blast this Google form at any time during until my class end. Okay, so please stay in my class or else you might miss my attendance. So this attendance will count.
Doctor, we start back at 3:43 or 3:35?
3:45.
3:45. 3:45
lah.
Okay, Doctor, thank you.
I give you some time to digest.
Alright, Doctor.
Because I want to show you a video, a short video on how this test has been carried out, and I will leave you an assignment. We will finish the class. Will not take long. For those who are not able to listen to me clearly, please voice out, yeah? Don't put in the chat while I'm talking because I'm not looking at the chat box while I'm talking. So please everybody fill in the Google form, because this Google form will be, I will use this Google form as your attendance, because as my experience, sometimes some of you might come in and just come in, just open your web meeting and then leave out. So I don't want it to be happen here. And I believe that all of you is very good listener and very good students. So everybody done? I think I don't want to wait until 3:45 lah. It's too long. I changed my mind. So okay. So I want to share with you a video which has been prepared by our lab staff on osmotic fragility test, so that you can see it clearly lah how it work out. Yeah. Can you see my window right now? Because I don't share.
We are going to do an experiment on osmotic fragility of erythrocyte.
I will share the link video.
So here you can see we already prepared the centrifuge tubes with sodium chloride concentration, different concentration from 0.1, 0.2, 0.35, 0.4, 0.45, 0.55, 0.6,
0.75, and 0.85 of percent
of sodium chloride.
Can I hear the audio? We can't see the video.
Sorry?
We can only hear the audio, but then we can't see the video.
Oh, really? Okay, wait, yeah, I'll try to share one more time. Okay. Right now, can you see? Vijay, can you see?
The video? Yes.
Today we are going to do an experiment on osmotic fragility of erythrocyte practical. So here you can see we already prepared the centrifuge tubes with sodium chloride concentration, different concentration from 0.1, 0.2, 0.35, 0.4, 0.45, 0.55, 0.65, 0.75, and 0.85 of percentage of sodium chloride solution.
Okay, by looking at this, you can see that actually in the table which I show you just now in a PowerPoint slideshow, I show that we have tube number 1 number until tube number 10 with the different concentrations of the sodium chloride. So you need to prepare 5 milliliter. You put 5 milliliter of different concentrations of the sodium chloride in each of the tube.
All of these are 5 mL each of different concentration in each tube. So after that, we also prepared already a blood containing an anticoagulant tube. This one is blood.
Okay, so we can assume that this blood is not necessarily a normal patient, a normal individual. It could be a person who have the spherocytosis problem, hereditary spherocytosis problem, or this might have hemolytic anemia, or these patients would have sickle cell anemia, or these patients would have thalassemia. So we do not know whether this is a normal red blood cell samples or abnormal red blood cell samples, and these red blood cells must be withdrawn and put inside the EDTA tube, anticoagulant tube, not let it to be clogged.
Okay. So this one we are using a micropipette, and this one is 2 to 20 microliter micropipette. So for this experiment, we already set this one to 20 microliter.
So 20 microliter is 0.02 milliliter. So why do we use a scientific or this pipette? Because the accuracy is very important. You cannot mix a different volume of blood in a fixed volume of the concentrations, or else the ratio of the solute to the ratio of the blood is very important, or else it might give a false positive or false negative result. Okay, so that's why we must use this pipette.
We need to draw 20 microliter of blood into each tube. So now we are going to take the 0.02 mil, which is the 20 microliter, and then we're going to insert.
Actually, there is a technique while you're using this pipette. When you pipette it out, you cannot touch the solute inside the tube. So please make sure that you are above the solute. And one more thing, to suck it out, you only press it one. To suck out the blood from the tube, you only suck out one. Press one only. One time press only. To flush the blood into the tube, into the solute, you need to press 1 and 2. Press it further down to flush all of the content inside the pipette. Okay, so that's a technique actually.
We already insert the 20 microliter of blood inside each tube. So this is how it will look like currently. Next, we will use the paraffin film to cover the top to go into the centrifuge later.
Okay, while looking at this, okay, look at these concentrations, you might see that which one already undergo hemolyze, even though you not mix it straight away. You can see which tube is actually undergo hemolysis. Okay, the tube which is appear to be clear like this, you can see behind here it's much more cloudy. You can see my arrow, right, my cursor. So behind here you might see that the solute already turned cloudy. So when it turns cloudy, meaning that the solute does not 100% undergo hemolysis. But when you look at the front over here, 1, 2, 3, 4 tube over here, you might see that the solute itself already become a bit clear, red, but it appear clear. So meaning that the cells is burst and you can see through is the hemoglobin. Okay, because the hemoglobin already burst and get out mixed with the solute.
So this is how you put the paraffin. So you just stretch it a little bit to cover test tube mouth, and then you can cover it nicely. Like this. So it's covered fully. So after we have already paraffin all the test tube, now we can mix the contents in each tube gently. And then you need to repeat this step for every test tube and allow every test tube to sit at room temperature for 20 minutes. After the 20 minutes, we need to mix the contents in each test tube again before sending to the centrifuge.
You can see the front tube 1, 2, 3, 4
is the centrifuge we are using.
Hemolyzed.
And for this experiment, we are using the 2000 rotation per minute. And by this, you can adjust through this one. So this one is 20 rotation per minute times 100. That means 2000. And we are using for 5 minutes. So you open this one, and this is how it looks like. So you just need to balance out. Looks like when balanced. So we put 5 here and 5 here. Close it. And then you just press start. So we already finished. Just take it out. So we will proceed later with the spectral photometer.
So we can see them.
So let me just. So here is the observation after centrifuge, and this one 0.85. You can see there is pellet down there. Alright. So you can observe from 0.55 onwards, actually there are still the pellet, the blood is still intact, but the lysis is already starting to occur. And whereas for the 0%, actually it's completely lysis already. So after the centrifuge process, now we proceed with the spectrophotometer. So before you can measure the other concentration, we need to blank first. So we are using the distilled water as a blank. And we need to put a clear surface. Let's wipe it first. So when we are doing the, you see there's an indication of the arrow here. So the clear surface must be facing the arrow because it's where it will be direction of the light pass through. So after that, you press zero. Alright, so you can see 0.000. Then we can start measure the other concentration. So we will proceed with 0% first. 0%. So we will repeat the process using the 0.1. Then, as usual, we will wipe it and measure. And it will be continue the measurement until 0.85. So after the spectra, we already get the absorbency of each concentration. And from the absorbance itself, you can calculate the percentage of hemolysis by using this formula. Absorbance of fast supernatant over the absorbance of 100% hemolysis.
Okay, so that's the tutorial for how do we do your osmotic fragility test. So, okay, look back at this table. Okay, so you need to jot down the percentage of hemolysis that you get, okay, just now, and then you need to plot a graph like this. Okay, and then look at this, my sharing screen. Okay, look at this table. You might see that you need to plot down one line, dotted line over here, and then dotted line down below here. Okay, you might see that at the 100% or at the 60% or 50% of the hemolysis. So the normal red blood cell will take at what concentrations of sodium chloride? If that patients would have less resistance, so meaning that the persons would have the hereditary spirocytosis. If that person is much more resistant, meaning that the percentage of hemolysis is lesser than the normal one, means that the persons might have thalassemia or sickle cell anemia. Okay. So I would share with you this YouTube link so that you can see by yourself later. You can watch by yourself later. I will put the link in the chat box. Okay, what I want you to do, please jot down, this is an assignment for you. The YouTube link is in the chat box. Okay, you can watch whenever you are free and look back at the results which Ms. Kaylin has shown you just now in the video. I want you to plot a graph and then send the soft copy of your graph to my email. So this is my email in the chat box also. Okay, so send your graph. Please put down your metric number, your ID number, your name and your ID number, and then make a very beautiful graph based on the result which Miss Kaylin has shown you in the video, and then send it to me by latest on Friday. Okay, by latest Friday. Okay, any questions you want to ask?
No.
Any question from all of you? Okay, so if you have no questions, I think that will be the end of our sessions today. If you don't understand, please feel free to chat me. This is my WhatsApp number. You can contact me personally. Okay. Please make sure that you have filled in the Google form as your attendance. Watch the video, and your assignment is to plot a graph based on the video which has been shown by Miss Kaylin in the video, in the YouTube video, which I shared the link with you already in the chat box. So if you have a questions, please feel free to text me and send your assignment latest by Friday. Okay, so that's all from me. I think, any questions you can ask, or if you don't have questions, you can miss the class.
Thank you, doctor.
You're welcome.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you, doctor.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Please make sure you send your assignment. Okay.
Doctor, I have a question.
Yes.
So we only need to do the graph only, like just plot a graph and then send it to you. Only graph.
Yes. And then please let me know whether this person is normal or abnormal. Find the source, find the normal hemolysis graph, and then see either the person's, this patient sample is normal or abnormal, or it is more resistance or less resistance.
Okay. Thank you.
All right, you're welcome. Vishnu? Oh, Vishnu is leaving. Can anybody send me Vishnu contact number?
Okay.
Just send WhatsApp to me. Okay? Thank you. See you again next time. Miss Kayleen, you still there, Miss Kayleen?
Yes, doctor.
Okay, that's the end of our session. You may leave if you want to. Thank you, okay, anyway. All right.
Thank you, too, doctor.
Right.